Good evening. So today's conversation is about looking at Guernsey as an organization, as an institution, or I would say rather as a jurisdiction for offshore investment fund management. So for those in this space, you would be aware that it's similar to Mauritius or Cayman or BVI. Guernsey is one of the upcoming popular jurisdictions in this space. So today's conversation is trying to understand what it is all about and what the benefits are for that, from that for using that as a channel for making an investment into certain parts of the world. As we move on, I would like to thank Thirumal and Jugal for their assistance in getting the proposal done. These are some of the terms, friends. SICRA, Channel Islands Competitive and Regulatory Authorities, CIVs, Collective Investment Vehicles. FATF is Financial Action Task Force. And GFSC is Guernsey Financial Services Commission. IOSCO is International Organization of Securities Commissions. Yes, so we would be seeing a comprehensive perspective, I mean, view on what Guernsey is, what it offers, what are the tax rates, when you can do, what you can do there, and what are the vital statistics of that particular region to give you a perspective on how people have been using this jurisdiction for investments. So Guernsey is part of a group of islands, which is typically referred to as Channel Islands. It's very close to about 120 kilometers south of UK and 50 kilometers west of France. Guernsey is an independent clutch of islands, and it celebrated 800 years in 2004, but still has its link to the UK via the crown and not through the parliament. It has its own set of regulations and rules, and is not technically governed by the UK laws and regulations. What are the primary advantages? First, of course, the most important reason why people use it as an offshore jurisdiction is it has a low tax network. It's got a reasonably good amount of treaty network and tax information exchange agreement network, good number of international banking institutions. The rating of the jurisdiction is A- under S&P, and it's part of the pound currency regime. So of course the currency is a fairly stable currency. The legal system, especially the trusts and the fund system, has been at least four decades plus in operation. Accessible government services and advice, resilient and high secure data connectivity, and a fairly well-developed professional service ecosystem. I think these are some of the main reasons why people look at Guernsey as a jurisdiction. It's been an international financial service center for more than 50 years now. And some of the main reasons or main pillars of this particular IFSC program has been banking, insurance, investment management, investment funds, and trust institutions. Now, unlike India, India is, I would say, a net importer of financial services. Guernsey is effectively thriving on financial services as a very significant part of GDP. We will be seeing that in some time from now. So the Guernsey Financial Services Commission is a regulator body for the finance industry in the bailiwick of Guernsey. And it's a fairly transparent and an open institution. Just to give you a perspective, friends, at its peak days, Mauritius handled anywhere between 13 to 14,000 global business corporates, GBCs. So Guernsey so far has supervises and regulates over 2,000 licensees. So that's the number of funds or institutions which have been set up via these regulations. And the best part is, the financial services regulator is part of the Basel Committee, the IOSCO, the International Association of Insurance Supervisors, and also is also a member of FATF. So you don't need to worry about Guernsey being in the gray list or black list of certain developed jurisdictions. Guernsey, as we would see later, is part of the white list, so which effectively means that fund flow into and from Guernsey can happen seamlessly. So offshore investment and fund management, since the 1960s, the Guernsey had funds, had a funds business community. And over the last 40 years, it has evolved to be one of the largest offshore financial services centers in that region. It initially attracted some small closed-ended funds in the 80s and 90s, and began administering private equity funds, and which was also considered as one of its concerted strategy to attract talent and increase the trade balance. Guernsey Financial Services Commission, similar to your FSC in Mauritius of the island, adopted a more open, pragmatic approach towards regulation of its various financial products. Over a period of time, it's attracted a good number of marquee names in the fund management space and continues to do so, especially given the fact that the regulator is extremely transparent and proactive in this region. Makes it all the more interesting for people to look at this as an offshore space. And currently, there are about 1,000 investment funds and over 2,000 sub funds which are administering an AUM of about 286 billion pounds. To give you a perspective, friends, the total value of India-centric FPIs is roughly about $400 billion, administered sorry, is about $50 billion, administered through a network of 350 funds which are located outside India. So, of course, Guernsey is not being used popularly to get into India, but it's more used to get into the western side of the world. And a good number of high-profile players of in the fund management and the hedge fund space have kept their physical presence in this island to create a permanent establishment. And you would see, as we see, the size of the island is, I mean, the size of the population is extremely tiny. So a lot of immigrants move into this jurisdiction for the purposes of setting up their shop here. This is the most important piece, which I think which would be of relevance to most of us, tax rates. So individual tax rates is at 20%. So I think that's where the larger meat comes from. But as far as corporate tax rates are concerned, the base rate, the standard rate is 0%. But for entities doing certain specific financial services business, it's 10%. So they call them as company intermediate rate. These are entities which are engaged in the banking business, domestic insurance business, fiduciary business, intermediate insurance business, insurance manager business, fund administration business. Again, we're looking at fund administration where people sit out of the jurisdiction. Investment manager services. Here, if you notice, friends, collective investment vehicles are exempt from this 10% perspective. Operating an investment exchange, income from compliance and other related activities provided to the regulated financial services business. So for these institutions, these companies, it is at 10%. And for the other companies, it is 20%. But what is interesting is when we say the other companies, we're talking about institutions which are engaged in trading activities, which actually do business out of that region, income from ownership of lands and buildings, importation or supply of hydrocarbon oil or gas in Guernsey, large retailers with an investment with a taxable profit of £500,000 or more. Now, here, when we look at it, I'm sorry, just give me. Yeah, here when we look at it, friends, collective investment vehicle funds, which are offshore funds, they specifically apply for an exemption status. So, which effectively means they don't get taxed in Guernsey. And you would see that that's one of the reasons why financial services is such a thriving business model in Guernsey. We shall look at it in some detail because that's one reason why people use Guernsey. Offshore funds, investment vehicles, companies or partnerships or trusts can apply for specific exemption from tax in respect of income from sources outside Guernsey. And the best part is Guernsey doesn't have a withholding tax, so that also makes it very interesting. So exempt institutions may also invest on a tax-free basis in a relevant Guernsey bank deposit or any other body to which an exemption has been granted, or in the shares of a Guernsey company. So when we say tax-free basis, the income from these investments shall not be taxed. And similar to institute places like Dubai or other places, there is an exemption fee of £1,200. I think so. You don't need to pay tax; you pay a fee, irrespective of whether you have profits or otherwise. Now, when would you be eligible for the collective investment exemption scheme? First, you must be established either within or outside Guernsey. And the fund management activities should be done out of Guernsey. So effectively, your directors should come into Guernsey, have meetings in Guernsey, and then yes, you would be eligible for a benefit here. And the institution which is claiming this benefit should have whether it is registered in Guernsey or elsewhere, should be for the purposes of management of a specific collective investment vehicle or enabling investment into a specific CIV, the acquisition or management of assets of a specific CIV mentioned above, or facilitating funding or borrowing. So once you fall within this ambit, you should make a specific application to the Directorate of Revenue Service, based on which you would be eligible for exemption. And moment the exemption applies, you don't end up paying taxes. You will have a flat fee of £1,200. So the exemption shall apply or shall not apply in certain very specific cases. Because if you notice this, friends, for persons resident in Guernsey who are regulated by Guernsey Financial Services Commission, as long as they provide support services to the exempt body, exemption shall be considered relevant. Remuneration for the services for these people, for these support services, should be at arm's length basis. And there must be no investment or other property situated in Guernsey which is held other than investments which we mentioned, which we saw earlier. And the majority of the shares or units are not held in the beneficial ownership capacity of Guernsey residents. This is very similar to Section 9A of your Income Tax Act in India, where they don't want to give this exemption for offshores for residents out of that jurisdiction. Next, there is no withholding tax, but however, if it's payment to Guernsey resident individuals, there's a 20% withholding tax. And although lower rates can apply to the extent that income from which the dividend is paid is taxed at 20 or 10%. If the company has an exemption status, there is no requirement for withholding tax on dividends if it is paid to Guernsey residents as well. Guernsey does not have a GAR regime, but it has a broad general anti-avoidance provision which targets transactions where the effect of the transaction is primarily to avoid tax liability. But in practice, we look at these situation provisions more from a compliance standpoint than from an activity standpoint. International cooperation, this is very interesting because whenever we look at an offshore jurisdiction, this is something which we need. So, as far as FATF compliance is concerned, 48 out of 49 is the compliance list for Guernsey. So, which effectively means that fund flow into and from Guernsey shouldn't be a cause for concern. It's considered as one of the most transparent jurisdictions globally. There's an OECD, it's a member of OECD's white list. So, which effectively means that almost all developed countries by default accept transactions from Guernsey as legit. It's party to the multilateral MLI regime. It has signed 60 plus TIEA tax information exchange agreements and 13 full comprehensive DTAAs and 12 partial DTAAs. Now, this is interesting, friends. Guernsey has certain aspirational attributes which India is looking at, but of course the scale is unthinkable here. Look at the number of births and deaths. The total population is 60,000, so there's hardly any change in the population. So immigration and emigration, people coming in and moving out, is roughly about 3,000, 3,500. I think these are numbers which happen in a minute in India. So the GDP is about 3,270 million pounds at this point, and it's been marginally growing at 1-1.5% consistently over the last 10 years. Per capita GDP is very high at constant prices at 52,000 pounds. It's significant. It's significant, at least 10 times higher than India, if not more. The sectoral contribution, if you notice, the financial services sector is about 41%. So you clearly know that where the government's focus is, the government wants more and more people to focus on this jurisdiction. But what's really interesting is the subsequent slide. So one is about, so if you see the average median earnings about 4,000 to 6,000 in the financial services place, which is the highest as far as this economy is concerned. So there is very, very high interest and output which is coming out of this sector. Employment, again, your financial services sector contributes to close to 20%, 1/5 of the total number of employment opportunities generated in Guernsey. These are totally the funds which are operating at this point in time. Open-ended funds, there are about 48 open-ended funds and 180 closed-ended funds, and non-Guernsey funds are 57. So, I mean, value, I'm sorry. So total of 286 billion, what we saw earlier. Now, so this is a jurisdiction which we can certainly look at for investing in US. You notice the key jurisdiction, US is 13%, UK through open-ended schemes, UK is 9%, Luxembourg is 8%, Australia 1% is actually, I mean, shocking, because you literally move across the world. But for investing into Europe and US, this could be a good vehicle for consideration. And if you look at closed-ended schemes, again, friends, by far Luxembourg and US and UK contribute close to half of what the total investment funds which are being managed out of this region. Then you have Germany and Netherlands and Norway. So Guernsey is being used for a gateway into US and the European world. Comes to investment by non-Guernsey schemes, again, the investments are primarily, again, US is by far the largest. China is interesting. There is an 8%. So it typically means the European investors have aggregated into China via Guernsey. So this is what we call as a collective investment scheme. And again, India is at 3%. So there are some investments, at least we at least know two funds of one of our clients also moved into India via Guernsey-based fund. So this should give you a perspective on why Guernsey can be viewed seriously as an offshore jurisdiction. And as you see, the more the investments, today it's moving capital from one jurisdiction to another is one of the easiest things to do. And any jurisdiction which operates in a very transparent environment, the predictable regulatory framework, and more importantly, has easy access in terms of financial services and a very, very strong banking regime, I think is a complete checklist for any investor looking at a collective investment jurisdiction. So I think going by that, Guernsey fits a bill on most counts. So these were some of the thoughts, friends, on this conversation. Hope to catch you on some other topic of relevance this week, and happy Merry Christmas. Thank you.